5 through 10. And we'll be done with this section. So Revelation 13, 5 is as follows. If you're ready for the word of God, please say amen.
Amen.
You're already standing. Thank you. 13, 5. He was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and he was given authority to continue for 42 months. Then he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven. It was granted to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them, and authority was given him over every tribe, tongue, and nation. All who dwell on the earth will worship him, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If anyone has an ear, let him hear. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with a sword must be killed with a sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. Thank you. You can be seated. So, we have been looking at the Antichrist features. Okay? And we have previously looked at his arrogance, his activities, his ancestry, his authority, his acclaim, and his adoration. And tonight, we will look at his arrogance, his activity, and his admirers as we finish off this section of Scripture. So we're going to begin with the feature of his arrogance. And like his master, Satan, the Antichrist will be an arrogant blasphemer. Blasphemy will not be incidental, but blasphemy will be central to his operations. It will be part and parcel of who he is. And in verse 5, it refers to the phrase, he was given, refers to God's sovereign control over the events that are transpiring. God was the one who gave him this ability. The ability to blaspheme him, to blaspheme God. And God will allow the Antichrist to blaspheme, give him full voice and expression to this satanic wickedness that will cover the world at this time. Remember, sin has to run its course. This will be an environment outside of the saints where sin runs rampant. And he, the Antichrist, will exhibit a total disregard for the true God by continually, our text says, speaking great things and blasphemies. And the Antichrist blasphemies will not be subtle. They won't be politically correct. And they will be open. They will be outrageous. And they will be monstrous. Even to the point, as it says in 2 Thessalonians 2:4, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. In other words, the Antichrist will attempt to present himself as being God. And that's, is that not reminiscent of Satan's original desire? If you go all the way back to Isaiah 14:14, it tells us, it was Satan, Lucifer's desire to make himself like the Most High. And this is the fruition. This is the, in Satan's mind, I believe this is him engineering that goal so that he himself can sit as God. Now, Daniel predicted that the Antichrist will be characterized by this proud arrogance, these blasphemous words. In Daniel 7 and 8, it says that he will have a mouth that utters great boast. Later in verse 11, it mentions the sound of boastful words which the horn was speaking, representing the Antichrist. And Daniel further notes that the Antichrist will speak out against the Most High. They will verbally attack God. That's in verse 25. And then later in 11:36, it says he will speak monstrous things against the God of gods. So Antichrist's arrogance will surpass that of anyone else in human history. Do you see Do you see a rise of arrogance in our leadership these days? Really? I didn't notice that. Yeah, it's. I remember leaders that were that at least seemed to be very humble men. I remember a time. I remember a time in America where humility was in fact considered a virtue. But now in present day America, it's me all the time. It's the practice of me-ism. So the arrogance of the Antichrist, you can see us becoming a group of people that are tolerant of arrogance and that almost expect arrogance. And the Antichrist will be Satan's mouthpiece, and he will voice his master's frustrated rage. And who is Satan raging against? Well, Satan is raging against God. He's raging against anything that is of God. So he will be the supreme blasphemer in a world full of blasphemers. Yeah. The entire world will participate in this blaspheming of God, except for God's saints. And so hardened will be sinners' hearts by this time that the judgments, the wrath of God, as they are perpetrated on the people of the earth, will not elicit repentance from them, but it will in fact elicit more blasphemy. In Revelation 16:9, John has a vision where he records, men were scorched with great heat, and they blasphemed the name of God, who had power over these plagues, and they did not repent and give him glory. They will have become so anti-God by that time that they will understand that the plagues are from God, and they still won't repent. They will still harden their hearts. So Antichrist's blasphemy against God, our source text tells us, will include three areas specifically of blasphemy. There will be blasphemy of God's name, his tabernacle, and those who dwell in heaven. Now, when you think of, well, okay, they're going to be blaspheming God's name. They're going to take his name in vain, but it goes much beyond that. Because, scripturally speaking, someone's name represents all of who they are. How many times have you seen in Scripture where you read somebody's name, and then when you read what their name means, it gives you a great amount of insight into who they are? Tom was teaching on the Archangel Michael this morning. You know what Michael means? Strong man of God. So when he blasphemes God's name, it means that he blasphemes a summation of all God's attributes. And so comprehensively evil will Antichrist blasphemies be that he will include God's tabernacle. He's going to blaspheme, and he's going to blaspheme all those that are in heaven. That means the Antichrist will utter blasphemes at God's person, at God's abode. He's going to curse heaven, and at God's people. Both, when it refers to those who dwell in heaven, who dwells in heaven? Two. Saints and angels. He's actually going to he doesn't like the angels that didn't follow him, so that's not really a big surprise. But he will blaspheme all those that abode still in heaven. So neither Antichrist's blasphemies nor his reign of terror will last indefinitely, because again, in our source text, it says that he has authority to function, to continue for 42 months, okay? So Antichrist and Satan will be allowed to operate within this time limit that's set for them by the true ruler of the universe. But for a few years, especially for the great tribulation, the second half of the tribulation, they will be the dominant force on the face of the earth. That is the arrogance of the Antichrist. Okay? So let's look at his activities. Okay? So now, don't take me wrong. The Antichrist will be a blasphemer, but he will do more than just talk. The Antichrist will be very decisive, and he will be very deadly in his actions. And once again, our text notes that the Antichrist can only do what has been given to him to do. He has permission to function in this way by Almighty God, and that stresses for us, that helps us understand that God never relinquishes his absolute control over world events. Because there will be those that will refuse to worship the Antichrist. Will there not be? Yes, there will. And the Antichrist will then, our source text says, make war with the saints, and he's going to overcome them. Believers in the true God during this time will bear the brunt of Antichrist's murderous fury. Remember, by this time, when you're in the Great Tribulation, people can only function in society with the mark of the beast. If you don't have the mark of the beast, you're not going to be able to buy anything. You're not going to be able to sell anything. You won't be able to procure medicines. All Christians will have to, in some way, function in a secret society. So the Antichrist will spend his time and his minions, the demons that are running all over the face of the earth by this time, will spend their time hunting down hunting down believers. And it will only be by the protection of God that believers will not perish, but many of them, as the text indicates, will be overcome. He will perceive them. See, the Antichrist will perceive anyone that's not on his side is a threat to his authority over, our text says, every tribe, tongue, and nation. And we've had that phrase several times in the book of Revelation. That phrase simply means over the world. Every tongue, tribe, and nation. And his temporary authority that's granted to him by God will lead to a worldwide slaughter of God's people. Okay? Daniel, long time ago, predicted that widespread martyrdom of God's people. In 725, he wrote that the Antichrist, it says, shall persecute the saints of the Most High and shall intend to change times and law. Remember we talked about that? They're going to change the law. They're going to change history. Sound familiar? That's what it means to change times and law. They're going to change all that, and by doing that, they will be able to persecute the saints of the Most High. Then the saints shall be given into his hand, his being a little h, for a time and times and half a time. Times is two, time is one, and then a half a times is a half, 3.5 years, okay? That Antichrist will successfully make war with the saints and overcome them. Does that mean that he will have the power, though, to destroy their faith? You've got to remember that. And that's the important part. He can't destroy their faith. He will overcome them physically, many of them, but not spiritually, because genuine saving faith is indestructible. And in our Romans lessons, we've just looked at that in the last chapter when we were in Romans 8, 38 and 39. It says, neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Those references to angels, principalities, and powers are all references to demonic forces that cannot overcome you. Because once you are saved as a child of God, you are sealed unto salvation. The Lord Jesus Christ, who is infinitely more powerful than Satan or the Antichrist, will not permit one of his true children to suffer the loss of their eternal life. But Antichrist will slaughter many of God's people on an unprecedented scale. And he will use And he will use his slaughtering of people to press his dominance upon the world. People will be scared into worshiping him because there will be nothing else to go to. So those are the activities of the Antichrist. And then the next section is his admirers. So in this section of our source scriptures, as we look at the admirers of the Antichrist, earlier on in verse 4, we saw that all the earth will worship Antichrist. And here again we see the same message, but there's a change in the tense, from a past tense to a present tense. In our text tonight it says, all who dwell on the earth will worship him. And as we have discussed before, the phrase, all who dwell on the earth, is used throughout Revelation, and it's not to describe everybody, it's used to describe unbelievers. It does not include everyone who is alive at the time. It does not include the believers. And here, we actually have a limiting factor. It says, all who dwell on the earth, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb, slain from the foundation of the world. These are the ones, then, who are not in the book of life, who will worship the Antichrist. Unbelievers who are not recorded in this book. 2 Thessalonians 2:10 tells us they will perish. Because why? Because they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. They didn't receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. Scripture also teaches that the faithless will be judged because they did not believe the truth but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Some versions will use the word wickedness. They took pleasure in unrighteousness. That's 2 Thessalonians 2:12. While the eternally elect are saved through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, the non-elect are lost because they refuse to believe the gospel. Unbelief and rejection always indicate those persons whose names are not written in the book of life. 7 times in the New Testament, believers are identified as those whose names are written in the book of life. I think 6 are in Revelation, 1 is Philippians 4:3. Now, the book of life belongs to who? Who does it say? The Lamb. It is the Lamb's book of life, who is the Lord Jesus Christ, and it is the registry in which God inscribes the names of those chosen for salvation, and it says that they were registered in this book before the foundation of the world. That's a phrase in theological speak. That's synonymous with eternity past. Before the foundations of the world, you could put in parentheses, from eternity past. Unlike unbelievers, the elect will not be deceived by the Antichrist, nor will they worship him, no matter what the cost. Antichrist will not be able to destroy this believing remnant's saving faith, because as the Lord Jesus Christ has promised back in 3:5, remember back in 3:5, he said, he who overcomes shall be clothed in white garments, and I will not blot his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. That's what we spoke of in this morning's service. Confessing Christ, he confesses us. Believers have been in the keeping power of God since before creation, and they will be there until the destruction of this order, which is temporal, which is minute, which is more where we live now is more unreal than the spiritual world. You know why? Because the spiritual world is eternal. this world is temporal. This is only temporary. This is all going to go away. So the things that we take for being concrete in nature now will not be concrete in nature. They will be things that will go away, and then the spiritual realm will become preeminent in all our minds, in all our hearts, in all our lives. So believers have been kept by the power of God before creation, and after this is all destroyed, and the new heaven is established, and the new earth is established, then we will be established. See, even the abode of believers in heaven now is temporal in nature, in reality. Everything, see, nothing can be as it's supposed to be right now because of one thing: sin. Sin will one day be gone. And then what happens? Perfection returns. As it once was, it will be again. But until sin is eradicated from the universe, perfection cannot return. Now, believers are actually doubly secure because the book of life does belong to the Lamb who was slain. Not only do they have a decree of election as reflected in the book of life, but they also have the atoning work of Christ that seals them for redemption for all the elect forever. Do you understand that? There's the book of life, but then there's the work of Jesus Christ that seals us by his atonement for us, by his paying the price for us. And because he's paid the price for us, we are his children forever. This is as 1 Peter 1:18 and 19 alludes to, as it speaks of believers not redeemed, it says, with corruptible things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, as a lamb without blemish and without spot. Perfection died for us so that we can be perfected. Okay? Everything in God's system, everything equates equally. When everything gets finished, everything is perfect. We know that the Father will not undo the work of redemption by allowing any of his elect to be lost. Hebrews 5:9 says, Jesus Christ is the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. To all who obey him. It is not within the power of the Antichrist. It is not within the power of Satan or all the forces of hell to alter the glorious reality of eternal salvation. The very saints that that the Antichrist massacres during his persecution of God's people are later seen in heaven victorious and triumphant. Revelation 15:2 through 4, listen to these words. And I saw something like a sea of glass mingled with fire, and those who have the victory over the beast, over his image, and over his mark, and over the number of his name, standing on the sea of glass, having harps of gold, they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, "Great and marvelous are your works, Lord God Almighty, just and true are your ways, O King of the saints, who shall not fear you, O Lord, and glorify your name, for you alone are holy. For all nations shall come and worship before you, for your judgments have been manifested." While Antichrist might be able to take their lives, the Antichrist will not be able to destroy their faith. So, in this passage of Scripture, we have this astounding vision of the beast coming from the sea, and it now calls, as this passage ends, it calls for spiritual understanding. And there's the warning here: if anyone has an ear, let him hear. And that warning, that phrase is used 15 times in the New Testament, and it's always used to emphasize an important truth. In all its previous uses in Revelation, it's been followed by the phrase, what the Spirit says to the churches. But that phrase isn't here because we know the churches have already left. So what we have here is this phrase that says, if you have an ear, let you hear. So this is something good for you to hear, okay? Do you have ears? Then I suggest you listen. And this is what it says. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with a sword must be killed with a sword. And then, here is the patience and the faith of the saints. Do you want to know what that means? That's right. If they take you to captivity, go to captivity. If you kill them with a sword, you should expect to be killed with a sword. That's not the way I have led you. That's not the witness that Jesus Christ wants, especially during the end times. He wants you to go as a sheep to slaughter, because that will speak more than all the words you can utter with your mouth. In a world that is completely victimized by evil, in a world run rampant with demons who have manifested themselves now upon their release from the abyss, in a world where blaspheming God is the normal thing, people that reflect this particular attitude will be a light and a salt. And I don't know if there is still time for anyone to be saved, but that is immaterial because the word says, if you have an ear, listen to me. And this is in essence a proverb. And what is a proverb? You know, we read the book of Proverbs. What are proverbs? Proverbs are merely statements of truth which were put into a format that makes it easy for you to remember and then to implement in your life. The words of Solomon are presented to us so that they speak to our hearts and minds and allow us to hold them within us so that we can be wiser people. They are practical truths that we can exercise in our lives. So here, those believers who are alive at the time of the Antichrist persecution, they are not to depend upon themselves, but they are to depend upon God's providence and not take their matters into their own hands. These believers will be led into captivity, and they are supposed to accept incarceration as being God's will. They are not to resist, and they are not to fight against the Antichrist. Amazingly, this passage, holds fast to the idea of capital punishment. If you read it, isn't that what it says? It says, if you kill by the sword, you die by the sword. That is an affirmation of capital punishment in reality. But God's people are not to retaliate against their persecutors. Christ did not retaliate against his persecutors. And there will be no place for that type of action then. There's no place for it now in reality. There's no place for militants or aggression or violent believers terrorizing their persecutors. The believers don't need to get little groups together and hunt down unbelievers. That's what the unbelievers will be doing. What's important to God, just as it is today, is your witness. It's your walk. It's not even, your words aren't even important. It's your witness. It's your walk. Because your word, you can say anything. It's your witness. It's your walk. It's your level of holiness that's important. Peter wrote in 1 Peter 4:19, he says, "Therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to Him in doing good, as He is a faithful Creator." In other words, give yourself to God, and no matter what the situation is, because God is good. God is aware of your suffering. God's not overwhelmed by what's happening to you, and He's going to be there with you. So instead of reacting violently, believers must exemplify, it says, the patience and the faith of the saints. They must be like Jesus, as Peter said, 1 Peter 2:23, he said, "Who," okay, "when they reviled him, he did not revile them in return. When he suffered, he didn't threaten, but he committed himself to him who judges righteously." In other words, as they reviled Christ, as they threatened Christ, he committed himself to his Father, who he knew would judge them righteously. When believers follow Christ's example, Peter noted again in 3:16 in that same book, "Those who revile your good conduct in Christ may be ashamed," it says, or some versions will say, "put to shame." And later in 4:14 he says, "Reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you." If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and God rest upon you. So the message of this passage of Revelation that we close tonight is clear. Let the monstrous beast from the abyss do what he has to do, because he is an instrument of the wrath of God, is he not? God's going to allow him to run his course. Satan and his demons will have their time. But God controls the future, and believers belong to God. It's as we read in Romans 8:37, "All these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us." Amen. And we will triumph on that glorious day when, as it says in Revelation 11:15, "The kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever." Amen? Amen. Questions on that passage before I start something new? Yes, Gerald?
Well, you're teaching us well on this. And I never even thought about it. I don't assume I'm going to be here when all this goes on. I hope I'm not. But now I know how I should act if I am. Are these people going to become Christians, are they going to know the word like this? Or are they going to be ignorant and not know what to do?
Well,
the natural instinct would be to fight back.
I think the gospel, the gospel will still be revealed in its glorious reality. Those that are God's people will understand how they should conduct themselves. Yes, Mike?
In verse 8, "whose names have not been written in the book of life," mm-hmm, "of the Lamb." Isn't there two books, the book of life and the book of the Lamb?
Well, I'll say there's two books, the book of life and the book of the living. That's referred to.
Be living and they belong to the Lamb.
And that's the book that's referred to when Moses pleads for the people, the Jewish people. And he says, "You can blot me out of the book of the living," which really is the book of those that are alive. It was commonplace in societies at that time. They kept books of the living and of the dead in cities to try to keep track of who was dead and who was alive. As far as the idea behind two books, I think we'll look at that a little more in depth later.
Because it does refer to a book of the Lamb.
Right.
But my point was, and as you said tonight, God knows who's in the book of life. Because isn't everyone that he ever created in that book of life? And some can be blotted out, it says in the Old Testament.
See, I believe that's the book of the living. And you can be blotted out of the book of the living. In fact, Moses said that you can blot me out of the book of the living if you will allow my people to not perish. So I believe that those are two different books. It's Psalm 66. It should be the book of the living. And they also refer to back in, I believe it's in Exodus 31. I think it's in 31 where Moses speaks to the idea of if you will allow these people, he feels as if God is ready to eliminate the Jewish people. And he says, if you allow them to live, then you can go ahead and take my life, in essence. And yes, I do believe those are two different books, and they have two completely different uses. But we'll look at that a little bit more later.
Where is the Book of Life supposed to be, or do you have any ideas on this? I've heard stories of the Jewish people having it when they read the Book of Life, when they have their services and things.
Well, they may refer, the Torah is in fact referred by to as some people as the Book of Life, but that's a completely different book. If there's a location for the Book of Life, that would be in heaven, under His abode and control. Other thoughts? And we'll look at that some more. That's a good question, Marty. I've taught on that, the Book of the Living and the Book of Life before. I forget what study was in, but. So, I want to go a little bit further, and we have a few more minutes, and I want to start this introduction. I told you, somebody came and talked to me in my office, and usually when one person has questions, then other people have kind of the same questions, and they were talking to me about the 70-week prophecy of Daniel. So I'm gonna look at that, and I'm gonna try to do it as quickly as I can, hopefully within just a few weeks. But I am lucky because I get to study all this great stuff, and I'm gonna specifically be in Daniel 9, 20 through 24. But as we come to Daniel 9, verses 20, 24, 27, we come to the most marvelous and exacting, amazing prophecy in all the Bible. You know that? In the mind of some writers, it's the single greatest defense of the divine authorship of Scripture. Sir Isaac Newton, you remember him? That's Fig's brother. Fig, and his brother Sir Isaac. You didn't know that? That they were relatives? Newton was the guy with the apples, wasn't he? And his brother, Fig, was the guy with the fig. But Sir Isaac Newton once said, we could stake the truth of Christianity on this one prophecy alone made 5 centuries before Christ. One prophecy we could stake the truth of Christianity upon. So we could stake, if we understand this prophecy correctly, we can give great credence to our own faith and help other people understand who Jesus is. And that's a powerful statement. But it is a monumental prophecy, and you'll see as it begins to unfold how monumental it is. And of course, like I said, it's going to take me more than a week or two to get through it because it's just so rich and there's so much to it. But we'll take our time to understand the fullness of all the Spirit has to say about it. So in this short introduction tonight, let me remind you of the scene that's taking place at the time of Daniel 9, as we approach that 9th chapter of Daniel, where we're going to jump in at the 9th chapter, so I want you to know what's going on beforehand. I'd really like to start with Daniel 1:1, but then you'd be mad at me. I'd really like to start with Daniel 9, because that's a primer on proper prayer. Daniel 9, 1. The prayer of Daniel has so much to teach us, but that'll be another lesson at another time. But what we have, after the reign of Solomon, the kingdom of Israel, remember what happens to it? It's divided into two parts, okay? And the northern kingdom is known as?
Israel.
And the southern kingdom is known as?
Judah.
In Israel, by this time, in Daniel 9, has been taken into captivity. They have been dispersed by the Assyrians. The Assyrians have come in and they have wiped them out. They have taken all their finest people, all their finest materials, and they've taken it all home, and they've integrated the people into their society, and they've run everybody else out of the country, and that way, that nation can never rise again. That's how the Assyrians did things. So, Israel's out of existence by this time. The northern kingdom and the southern kingdom of Judah, the southern half of the divided kingdom, has also been taken into captivity by the time of Daniel 9. And who has taken them into captivity?
Babylonians.
The Babylonians. And there are three deportations that take place under the Babylonians, and it's important to know when they are because they play into the prophecy of 70 weeks. The first one is about, and these are abouts, when the first one under Nebuchadnezzar himself came about 605 or 606, okay? And that's when he came in, as was the case, and took the leaders. He took the brightest and smartest minds, and he took them back to his country to make his country better, and the country they had conquered worse. And then he would charge them taxes, he would, and if they didn't behave, he would come in and squash them again and take more from them. And if they still didn't behave, he'd come in again and he would annihilate them. And that's in essence, that's what happens in 586. But he takes these, in this first deportation, he takes three friends, Mishael, Hananiah, and Azariah, and they become known to us as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And Daniel is included in this first deportation. So the nation of Judah, the people of God, by this time are in essence in captive in the land of Babylon. And Babylon, as we're reading in Revelation, would be the first great Gentile world empire. And there will be four great Gentile world empires. Babylon,
Medo-Persians,
the Greeks, and the Romans. Okay? So Daniel has taken, he's been taken into captivity, and he, because of his amazing commitment to God, and because of who he is, Daniel's a very unique individual. He's an incredible personality. He's charismatic. And because of the character that God has given him, this person that was deported to Babylon, in essence, becomes the prime minister of Babylon. That's a big deal in the old world. Kind of reminds you of Joseph. But even though he was a Jew in exile, the qualities that he had caused him to reach the very highest place in the land. He was right under the king. And so Daniel at the particular time of chapter 9 is the prime minister of Babylon. And so the Babylonian Empire, however, by this time, has itself been defeated. Okay? The Medes and the Persians now have power. And the king of their nation is Darius, who I believe is the same as Cyrus Darius. Because it's a title rather than a name. He's in power. And so we find at this particular moment in time that the people of God have been in captivity for approximately 70 years. They've endured the Babylonian Empire, the fall of the Babylonian Empire, and now they are living under the power of the Medes-Persians. And interesting enough, Daniel, again, because of his character, is still held in this same position. The Babylonians have been defeated. The Mede and Persian Empire has come over and taken over, and they've left Daniel as the prime minister. So, and some scholars believe the time that we're looking at here in Daniel 9 is around 537 BC, right on the cusp of 70 years after the first deportation. And Daniel, who was part of that first deportation, is very concerned about the 70 years coming to an end. Why?
He read it in Jeremiah.
And Daniel is a scholar of the Word of God. And in 9:2, he says, in the first year of the reign of Cyrus of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, I, Daniel, understood by books the number of the years. So he understood by books. He was reading the Old Testament, and he was understanding the number of the years. And then it says, concerning which the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah. Jeremiah had mentioned several times that this captivity would be a captivity that would last for 70 years. So Daniel is trying to figure out when that 70 years is up, and he's not sure emphatically which deportation it applies to, but I think he thinks that the time is coming, and therefore it is weighing on his heart. Now, Daniel is of such an age, you think he was a young man when he was deported. 70 years have transpired. He's an old guy. And Daniel knows he's not going to go back. He's too old, but he still has a heart for his people. For 70 years, the Jewish people have lived under Gentile oppression, domination. And because of that, Daniel has a desire to seek out the word of God, and he's asking God in his prayer life to bring this captivity to an end, and he wants the people to be brought back to their land. And now, in an answer to his prayer, God is going to give him this prophecy, the most monumental prophecy in the Bible in many ways, which occurs from verses 20 through 27 as his prayer occurred in verses 3 through 19. And that's the introduction. We'll begin the actual study next week. Okay? I want to read this at a time of prayer. Pray with me. Father, as we come before you this evening, Lord, it's our desire, Lord, for us. We believe, Lord, that you want to work through our lives, that you want to call us to be your people. But we understand also, Lord, that it's up to us to believe. And Father, as we come before you tonight, we open our hearts to your leading in our lives. And Father, it's my prayer as we take this time to come before you after we've studied these end times, Lord, we just want to make sure that we understand where and how we stand with you tonight. So, Father, we come to you in prayer and pray that your hand will move amongst us as you desire, not as we desire. I pray, Lord, that you'll help us to put aside all hindrances to your communication to our hearts, that you will allow us, Father, to function as you desire and allow your calling to be evident in our lives. Father, we are merely people trying to find our way in a world that's lost and undone. And Father, it's not easy sometimes, and it's not always evident to us that all things, how you function, but Lord, we know you do function. We do believe, Lord, as a body of believers, that you do call, and then you give us the faith to exercise belief. You give us the faith, Lord, not so that we might do what we want to do, but so that we might do what you want us to do. So, Father, we're going to remain with our heads bowed and remain with our eyes closed, and we're going to give you this time, Lord, to work in our lives. Will everyone just continue to pray in a silent manner and allow God to work in our hearts and our lives this evening.
just continue to pray.